Our moderator for this session is Shehryar Fazli. He is the senior analyst, South Asia regional editor for the International Crisis Group, and an independent Brussels-based non-profit organization focused on resolving deadly conflicts. He is the author of the novel Invitation, which was a bestseller in India and Pakistan on its release in January 2011, and was runner-up for the 2011 Edinburgh International Book Festival's award for the first book.
Thank you, and thank you all for being here. Good morning. Welcome to the last day of this year's Islamabad Literature Festival, and welcome to this hour with two very compelling writers whose work is very different, but whose novels nevertheless speak to each other. And I think it's going to be quite valuable to have them on one stage. So thank you both for being here. I'll do a quick introduction and then get the conversation going. Immediately to my left is Sabyn Javeri, who is the author of the best-selling political thriller Nobody Killed Her. And her short fiction has been published in various places internationally. They explore issues of gender, identity, and displacement, and have been widely anthologized. And she's won the Oxonian Review Short Story Award and was shortlisted for Meridian Leaf Books and the first Tibor Jones South Asia Prize. She holds a master's with distinction from the University of Oxford and has a PhD in creative writing from the University of Leicester. She currently teaches creative writing at Habib University in Karachi. Omar Shahid Hamid has served as a senior counterterrorism officer in the Karachi police and in Pakistan's intelligence bureau for 14 years, one of those typical officer novelists. Following that, he's worked in political risk firms in London. He has a master's degree in law from the University College London, and in criminal justice policy from the London School of Economics. He's a frequent contributor in the international press, and he's written three best-selling books, The Prisoner in 2013, The Spinner's Tale in 2015, and his latest is The Party Worker, which was launched at the 8th Karachi Literature Festival. The theme, as you see, is crime fiction, and we're going to play with the idea of first of all, what the conventions of that genre is and how these writers fit into it, but perhaps more interestingly, transgress and overturn it. So the first question I want to ask is, to what extent you see yourselves belonging to a particular literary tradition, whether it's while you were writing, or once the novel already came out and the discussion novels came out and the discussion around it developed, and what risks and opportunities there are in thinking of yourself as working within a particular genre or tradition. Let's start with you, Sabyn.
Why don't we start with Omar?
All right, Omar.
Seniors first.
I think it's interesting because in both of our books, I've never written based on placing myself in a particular genre. I've always sort of had this thing that if you have interesting stories to tell, you write. It so happens that some of those stories got classified as crime fiction, but for instance, in Sabine's book and in my new book, I think you can equally place both books in the genre of political thrillers rather than crime fiction, because they both deal with political subjects. So I'm not quite sure sort of how or where to place myself. It may be that in the future I write something that's totally removed from what I've done so far. I think it's, for me, it's something that's flexible.
Well, first of all, thank you, Shehryar, for doing this session. I agree with Omar. I don't think, you know, one consciously sets out to write in a particular genre. And as he rightly pointed out, it could very well fall under the genre of political fiction if one must box it. As far as belonging to a literary tradition is concerned, I do like to think that, you know, I come from this very rich literary heritage of writers like Isma Chagatai, Rashid Jahan, who have always broken taboo conventions, you know, have always written about unconventional subjects like Chagatai, for instance, wrote Lihaf, which was her first published short story, and it created a lot of furor. There was a lot of controversy. I don't think she consciously set out to break any norms, but she reflected the society around her, and she wrote about that. And that gives me courage, you know. And I feel that possessing such a rich literary heritage, I feel that there is a responsibility to carry that on. Mm-hmm. So in that sense, I feel I do belong to a literary tradition, but not such, not a genre as mm-hmm. such, but a tradition of female writers.
So I appreciate very much both your points. Nevertheless, it's clear from the theme given to this session that readers associate you with a particular genre. And when one thinks of crime fiction, whether it's novels, whether it's movies or TV series, the characteristics are of, you know, nothing being as it seems, of sort of large hidden forces at work, following the clues of a crime towards some kind of truth. And in both your work, whether it's the story of an investigation, whether it's the transcript of a trial, is reminiscent of that. And I just want to ask you how you use that device and that schematic to explore issues of culture, identity, gender, etc. Let's start with you this time.
Okay. Well, I feel, you know, I've always been very interested in the psychological aspect of writing, how it provides a sort of an access to the deeper subtext of a culture. In that sense, we have a lot of free speech media in a way. Of course, if you go too far with it, you get picked up and you disappear.
We've got a cop right here.
Yes, right. I should be careful. Journalism in our country shouts, whereas books whisper. You know, books, literature, provide you with a platform to really say things which are not overtly discussed, but are huge forces in our culture and our society. So in that sense, you know, I felt this book provided me a medium to have two contrasting narratives. On one hand, we have the court trial, which is very much cold, hard facts of how things appeared to be. And then we have the narration of the protagonist, or rather the antagonist, who is telling you her point of view, how she saw things and how she justified her actions. So I use these twin narratives of reality and the interpretation of reality to provide a sort of a mirror to our society that things are not always as they appear. I hope
absolutely.
That answers your question.
No, absolutely. Well,
you know, this, I totally agree with Sabyn that writing fiction enables, certainly in my experience, has enabled me to look at a lot of issues that perhaps may be skirted over in the media or have not been addressed, because it gives you a certain license. And of course, you can incorporate a lot of things inspired by real life events or personalities, but it kind of allows you to focus on those types of issues, or as Sabyn said, put it, to shed a light on them. And I think for me, the tool or the format of a crime novel, or looking at it from the eyes of an investigation ongoing, is also very, very, it lends itself to this kind of thing, because if your work is an exploration into, let's say, a hidden world or something under the surface or something that's not talked about that much, then the tool of sort of framing it within a criminal investigation works very well in unraveling the story and the characters as they move ahead.
One thing that a reader often gets, I don't know if they expect it or not, with crime fiction, with mystery, is some kind of resolution, some kind of truth. And it, your work, both of you don't necessarily provide that. Why not give readers those comforts that they crave?
I hate redemption. Yeah, we're just pure evil. You know, we want to take you to this point and then leave you dangling. For me, I feel the writer's job is to, you know, Chekhov once said that the writer's job is not to provide answers, but to pose the question in the right way. I'm a firm believer of that. I think, you know, especially the devices I've used, the unreliable narrator, I think you can take a reader there, but you don't necessarily have to hit them on the head and say, this is what I meant, or this is the end. And really, I don't believe in endings. You know, I think life is, unless you are dead, okay, even when you're dead, there's always, you know, the possibility of a hereafter. So I feel, you know, why should a book have a closed ending? You know, it should be open-ended. It should be open to interpretation. There should be light at the end of the tunnel.
Yeah, welcome to the real world where there is no resolution. I think it having that degree of vagueness, I found, made my writing, at least to me, and to the best of my knowledge, to those people who've read it, more interesting. I also think that, you know, had I provided that kind of resolution, my books would then have fit very much more clearly into that, you know, very typical crime fiction genre where there's a crime and at the end of the book, it's resolved.
You get the bad guy.
Over here, with a degree of ambiguity, it makes it more interesting as a writer, and I think also as a reader.
And I also think that, you know, it's a way of involving the reader in
exactly.
your narrative.
Yeah.
You know, the reader is as much part of the decision making as the writer is.
It's left to the reader to choose what he or she may want to take out of that.
Sabyn, you mentioned unreliable narration. Can you just say a little bit more of that? Because it seems to me that, you know, in real life events and real life crime, the truth is always elusive. And that leads to questions about how reliable any version of the truth, so-called, is. Can you just say a little bit more about what you mean by unreliable narration and how you've deployed that?
Okay, having grown up in Pakistan, I've always been very fascinated by how people have these black and white versions of truth, true and false. You know, there's always the right path and there's always the wrong path. And I've always wondered, you know, a crime to someone may be a good deed to another person. You know, it's always subjective. My truth may be different than yours, but at the end, it's all about faith, right? So that's something that's really always fascinated me about growing up in a society which is very clear in its boundaries and its restrictions and its approvals. When I went abroad after my undergrad and I had, I studied different literatures, different kind of subjects, I realized that, especially in social sciences, there aren't any closed truths. Everything is open to interpretation. And that, I think, trickled into my work. When I say unreliable narrator, I mean a character who is not necessarily telling you things exactly as they happened. The reason I employed this technique in my book was because I wanted the reader to have a chance to really think for themselves, to make up their own mind. I don't like the idea of anyone telling any other person what is right and what is wrong, be it you know, the law, or be it a book of fiction. So that was one way of employing the unreliable narrator technique. The other was that, you know, I find this very problematic, this either saint or devil kind of attitude in society. And I thought the unreliable narrator was an interesting technique to show flawed characters, to show the grayness in society.
Omar, you being a cop, first of all, let me say I don't want to upset you. And I don't want to ask you a question that I'm sure you've been asked a lot, which is how much of you is present in your characters. But what I am interested in is how you deal with what you know. In that, as a cop, you obviously have a level of knowledge and of detail that others do not. How do you manage that information? How do you, is it a burden knowing so much when you're translating that into an artistic work?
Absolutely. I think in each and every one of my books, when I sort of started them, they were based on themes or stories that I had come across in my professional career. And in every single one of, in every single case, I have had to water things down, because I think there was information overload. There were too many things that ideally you would want to ram into that work. And I've also often said this, that when you come across and see a lot of the things that, for instance, a police officer sees, people looking at it from the outside world, outside that sort of world of law enforcement, would perhaps say, this is just beyond, you know, this is just not believable. It's too weird or too strange to be incorporated. So you actually do have to water things down. You have to water down a lot of the nuances, you know, especially when it comes to things like when you speak about institutional corruption. There may be many practices that may make a lot of sense to someone sitting within that system, but to kind of really break them down for a reader who does not have any exposure to them beforehand would lead you off tangent and away from the main theme of the story. So there's a lot of, in my view, watering down of the content that I have, you know, that I receive directly.
And do you feel that sacrifices anything?
It hasn't so far. There's often cases where there are bits and pieces of information that I will, you know, put in a first draft and then take out, and then I'll keep them in for a future reference, perhaps to be included in another book or you know, something else that I write. So I don't think it's massively toned down the content. I personally at times feel that, oh, you know, perhaps this is an oversimplification, but I don't think that anyone else has made that comment about my writing so far.
So you do have all the answers, huh? And you're just like keeping them.
Well, more questions than answers.
And Sabyn, you also work with a lot of public material, and that public events are a big part of the life of your novel. Similar question, management of information. You might have a reader that doesn't know the context very well. How did you decide to, you know, share, withhold? Is it a difficult decision, or is it pretty natural?
To be honest, I'm not a very, you know, political person. I don't have inside information. I don't work in crime. My novel was purely, you know, imaginative. I just took, you know, something I'd heard, something I'd read, bits from here, bits from there, you know, something that happened in Burma, something that happened in Pakistan, something that happened in India, and I just pieced it together to make an interesting narrative. You know, there wasn't a huge thought out piece of research behind it, because I think one of the tools that a writer has is imagination, and you know, it can take you anywhere you want to.
So then coming back to something that you mentioned earlier, or even if the characters aren't based on a real single individual, you both have characters that are very reminiscent of figures in our public life. A female political leader who's assassinated, the Don. What does...
And we're not talking about Amitabh Bachchan.
Given that we read about these figures or these kinds of figures in a lot of other forms, could you say a little bit more about what the novel offers as a form in its ability to show you something about these figures that the other forms do not?
I feel, you know, the novel offers you the opportunity for fictional exploration, and it would be very limiting to constrain it to just the life of one single individual. I mean, you have biographies for that, right? Why write a fictional exploration? Where else my novel does lean quite heavily on, you know, taking characteristics of, you know, our very charismatic female politician leader, it is not solely based on her. I have taken the idea of an unresolved assassination, but then I've taken characteristics of different female leaders from all over the region of South Asia, and I find it quite funny actually that we don't seem to acknowledge that there have been other powerful female leaders in this region. There's Sheikh Hasina with her background of, you know, also being the skin of a political dynasty, her rivalry with in Burma you have a female politician who is exiled fighting dictatorship. You know, in India you have Indira Gandhi and her very interesting transition from a very idealistic politician to an absolute autocrat. You have the rise of the underdog in India, where you have, you know, Jayalalitha and Mayawati rising from the ashes and doing all sorts of things to get to where they are, whether they are, you know, vilified for it or whether they are, looked down upon. So we have a very interesting history of female leadership in this region alone, you know, and I've tried to draw upon all of that and see what is it about a woman being in a very male-dominated political world, and what does it take for a woman to rise to power and, more importantly, to hold on to that power. And I think the novel is an excellent tool to explore that.
And is there anything you are saying about the assassination of a female political leader that would be different, say, to the assassination of a male political leader? Is there a difference there?
The assassination is just a technique to go back into flashback. You know, the trial is actually a metaphor for a bigger trial. You know, it's almost an analogy with Sita's trial, you know, of whether did she cross the line or did she not cross the line. If she did cross the line, what were her reasons, whether she really was pure or not. So that's what the whole crime trial is about. You know, it really isn't about an assassination, and no, it does not provide any answers to who killed who. Mm-hmm. It's just a fictional technique to explore a deeper issue.
I think, you know, when you're writing a character, it's good to have, obviously we all draw inspiration from whether it's news headlines or current events or whatever, and especially if you're writing the sort of books that Sabyn and I write. But it's far more interesting to take a public figure, you know, as the first sketch, and then to color the lines in yourself. For instance, I have found it fascinating whenever I've been writing various protagonists in my books to try and put yourself in their shoes. So, you know, you have the concept of an individual who is a political leader living outside, living in exile and controlling a city by remote control. And then it's more interesting to then sort of say, okay, what would I do if I were in that situation? You know, what would be my triggers to sort of push things around? And I think that's where, for me, while writing, character development becomes very, very interesting when you kind of conduct these sort of exercises, rather than if it was a straightforward etch-a-sketch of taking, an existing figure and mapping them onto the book.
Yeah,
and are you denying that your book is about the assassination attempt of Jayalalitha?
Are you denying that the Dawn in your book is Amitabh Bachchan?
I always deny that. I'll say anything to sell books.
Yeah. You police mind you.
I, for one, don't care who reads my book at all. The only thing that matters is who buys it.
That's.
Yeah. Were you about to say something?
No, I was just reflecting on your profound wisdom.
It seems that it's very difficult, and understandably so, to write novels set in our part of the world without a lot of reference to public events, given how powerfully public events impact private life. Are there any, let's say it's advice you're giving to somebody who's starting out and is, tackling material like this, are there any risks artistically of anything to be aware of when you're undertaking such an exercise? And let me just add to that the, one concern that I always have is if Pakistan stops becoming big news around the world, what ensures that the interest in the novels remains when nobody cares about those public events anymore?
Do you want to take that
question? I'm not completely convinced that, Pakistani novelists are read because Pakistan is in the news. I think there might have been a time when there were certain Pakistani novelists who were, writing about a state which was, heavily consumed by terrorism and probably posing an international threat if the Taliban got hold of the nuclear codes or something like that. I think there is a huge wave of new Pakistani writers who actually live in Pakistan, who are writing about very interesting issues, who are political, but are writing about not just politics, but to people whom the politics happen. Mm. There are writers writing about transgenders, there are writers writing about love between different people of different religions, there are people writing family comedies, and there's just so much new work coming out by this new wave of Pakistani writers. They're very popular in India, they're very popular all over the region. I do feel that we still have that colonial hangover where we feel that unless a book is validated by the West, the writer hasn't made it, but I think it's changing very quickly. I think there's a lot of appreciation of these new writers, and they're doing very well.
Yeah, I totally agree. I think what the success of books like Sabine's and mine have showed is that there is a huge domestic market, where people are interested in reading stories about that are based in this part of the world. And it's not necessarily a case of pitching a story to the West. And as far as your original point about advice to people writing about public events, part of the issue I think is that with us, you're right that it's almost inevitable when you're writing in this part of the world. And the reason for that perhaps is that oftentimes public events have not really received the kind of academic or non-fiction coverage that they would do elsewhere, right? For instance, you know, to give you an example, you can read several books about the Mumbai attacks in 2008, you know, telling the whole story from a journalistic point of view, and tomes and tomes of academic research, but you won't find a single book dealing with the Lal Masjid siege, even to in a non-fiction way. And so oftentimes what does happen is that when you're writing fiction that pertains to or touches upon public events, people will often and inevitably read it as a story of how those events unfolded, which is not the case, but it is going to be unavoidable. And it's just something that if you're starting out as a writer, it's just something that you have to be prepared to deal with.
It reminds me of a quote by a Greek writer who said that the novel rises out of the gaps in history.
Yeah, absolutely.
Or falls between the gaps in history.
What I would like to do before we turn it over to the audience for questions is to actually hear some of your writing. So I'll ask you each to read from a passage from your work. But before you do so, do you have any questions for each other?
No, we have a pre-arrangement that we will not raise the issues of who killed Ranisha.
Or who the Don is. It's one of those things,
I'm happy,
you know,
to discuss who the Don is. I don't know. I hope the Don reads.
Don kharidenge aapke khayal se.
Nahin, someone, he'll extort it out of someone.
Okay, so by a figurative coin toss, Sabyn, take it away.
Okay, I would have liked Omar to go first, since we're burning him with sin.
It came up here.
Why don't you go first, because I need to find a...
You need to find a passage.
She's totally undermined the authority of the moderator.
Sorry. I'm a teacher, you see.
Okay, got it. Should I go first or?
Yeah, go ahead.
Okay. Call me Ismail, Ismail Naich. I read that in a book once. Not the Naich part, obviously, but the first sentence. They say that a book must have a catchy opening line. Very true, by the way. This line was from a book I picked up in Urdu Bazaar a few years ago. I think it was called Moby Dick, and it was about fishing or something. Why would I be reading something like that? True, it's not the sort of thing I would read under normal circumstances, but at the time I was preparing for a job interview with an American TV channel. Even though the job itself had no English requirement, they were setting up an office in Karachi and wanted a local crime reporter, I thought I would impress them with my knowledge. So for a brief period, I had started reading English novels. I remembered the opening sentence because the character had the same name as me. I never got the job with the American channel, but I thought at the time that if I ever wrote anything greater than a crime bulletin, I would try working that line in. I am a journalist by profession, chief crime reporter for the Daily Ehsaas. If you haven't heard of the paper, I wouldn't be surprised. It's an Urdu language tabloid, what we call an eveninger in Karachi. It targets the growing middle class of this city, feeding them a diet of stories about government corruption, police encounters, and steamy accounts of liaisons between various actors and actresses. How successful it is as a newspaper is a matter of some dispute. We claim to have a circulation of 1 million, but judging from the bundles of copies that are returned to our offices every day for pulping, I doubt whether so many people actually read us. The primary aim of the paper is to act as a vehicle to push forward the interests of our owner, Mr. Liaquat Khujli, of Khujli Builders fame. Being a builder in this city is no easy job. The profit margins are good, admittedly, but there are so many other problems. Political parties demanding bhatta, building control officials asking for bribes, gangsters threatening to kidnap you for ransom, and if nothing else, these bloody civil society NGOs start petitioning the courts if even one brick from one of your buildings falls out. So as you can imagine, a builder like Mr. Liaquat Khujli, who has taken a few shortcuts in life, needs all the help he can get. Thus, he decided to establish a newspaper. A free press can be a very useful weapon. Every time anyone wants to look into your affairs, you smear them with a strategically placed corruption story or an editorial about the fascistic tendencies of certain NGOs. It's like having yellow journalism on demand. Also, with the newspaper, political parties court you. You can always trade favors for endorsements or support. So what was a respectable journalist like me doing working at the Daily SRs? Well, first of all, I'm not particularly respectable, never have been. Like most Karachiites, I'm not originally from Karachi. I'm from Hyderabad, and I got into journalism not out of some altruistic desire to discover the truth, but rather because other options had dried up. I like to think that I was always a people person in school and college, which meant that I always preferred hanging out with friends to studying. That meant I would never have the grades to be a doctor or an engineer, or to even sit for the civil service exams. My father tried to use sifarish to get me appointed as an assistant sub-inspector in the excise department because the minister was from our village. But even that fell through because someone else paid the minister a bribe for the same job, and cold hard cash always works better than old village ties. So I went to Jamshoro University and studied journalism because there was no other choice. Being a small landowner, my father always understood the need for connections with government officials. After all, small landowners are totally dependent on these things. Thus, he figured that if I couldn't be in the government, it was good to be in a profession that had daily interactions with government officials. So that was my main motivation to be a journalist, to make contacts that would be helpful for my father and elder brother.
Storytelling, oral story tradition that comes through in your writing.
Let's see what you do with Nobody Killed Her.
Yeah, no, I just shouldn't have gone after you. Hard act to follow.
I died.
You're supposed to be, you're not supposed to agree with me. All right, okay, so Nobody Killed Her is a split narrative. There are two parts to it. One is a trial, which is in the present time, and the rest are reflections of the narrator, which are not necessarily reliable. So first, there are a few lines from the trial. Prosecutor. And this scene comes towards the, it's about 75% into the book. So there are two characters. There's Rani Shah, who's been murdered and whose trial is taking place. And then there's Nazu Khan, who is her confidant, maid, PA, who is on trial for the assassination. So the trial begins. Prosecutor. She began to think she was invincible. And as they say, pride comes before a fall. Counsel. Don't you feel, sir, the same could be said about Madam Shah herself? Okay, now we come to Nazu's narration, her interpretation of this transcript. If there was one thing I learned while you were in the hospital, it was this. Everything is about sex except sex itself. Sex is about power. And it was this power I wanted to take back from your husband. I wanted to break him, humiliate him, bring him to his knees. So I began to study him closely. His weakness, I knew, were horses, women, and money. I considered putting all three in a room and making a video, which I would then leak. I would make the happiest day of his life the saddest. But before I could put my plan in action, you came back from the hospital. The sight of you changed everything. I knew now that hurting Bilgodi meant hurting you. Loyalty, you see, was your greatest strength and your greatest weakness. It had been a tough labor, the doctors coursing their surprise on the unusually tough second birth after a simple home delivery the first time around. I wondered if you kept your front or squealed out and confessed at the first jab of pain. From what I heard, you held it together for a long while, but the stubborn baby refused to come out. Perhaps she knew what was in store for her. In the end, you opted for a cesarean, the pain being too much for you. You were discharged a week later. Once back, you tried to catch up on work, feeling exhausted amidst the new baby's wails. You put up a stoic demeanor, but the baby cried day and night. She clung to you, her small fists clutching your shirt with all her tiny might, like a leech, I thought. I watched you carefully. I wanted to see if there was any gratefulness or recognition. Hadn't I been right about motherhood? Hadn't I warned you? It sucks you in, Rani. At least at this stage in your career, you could afford to take a break. But would you be where you are now if you'd had children before contesting? Oh, Rani, aren't you glad I did what I did the first time around? But no, there was no remorse in your eyes. You seemed all right, even happy at times, to be spending time with a howling baby instead of solving the nation's problems. At times, Rani, your fallibility shocked me. Each time I looked at you, your housewifely behavior, your motherly instincts and stereotypical femininity not only disappointed me, but terrified me. I needed to look away, forget that I had once thought you were our Messiah. You were just another woman, a foolish woman. Everything about you was average. Average mother, average wife, average politician. You didn't want to do great things. A little bit of this, a little bit of that. Do you think Jinnah cared about his family when he was carving out a country? Do you think Gandhi fussed over his children's homework when he was resisting the British? Or how about that Abraham Lincoln, or even your favorite John F. Kennedy? Forget the men, Rani. Do you think Mrs. Thatcher got the title of Iron Lady by waddling around pregnant in public? Respect has to be earned, Rani. Leaders are made, not born. You either cared enough to be someone, or you didn't. Fueled by my anger, I began to take on even more under the table work. Yes, I did abuse my position. But I only took on work, Rani, which you should have. You began, you see, where I ended. Do we have time for more?
Sure.
Okay. I worked night into day to push my school's projects. People thought it was your drive, but I didn't care. I just wanted it to happen. I now knew my real power. It was all up here, in my brain. I feared no one, and in turn, everyone feared me. During the day, I went about my work, but at night, I tossed and turned, telling myself it didn't matter who got the glory as long as the job got done. But a tiny thought still lurked inside me, a voice mocked. A gatekeeper's daughter will remain a gatekeeper. Political dynasties in this country were like royal ones abroad, I found myself thinking. A woman could rule only if she was blue-blooded, and perhaps that was one of the reasons the people of this land had accepted you. Daughter of the Shah, they called you, but me? I was daughter of the soil, and like dust, I was worth nothing. Still, I kept on trying. You always said I was a stubborn one. And soon enough, the day came when people began to bypass you. They seemed to realize who was the real force. NGOs approached me, aid workers came to me, the poor and destitute knocked on the kitchen door, sure that their cause would be heard and their bellies filled. We had such high hopes for Madam, but she has done nothing for our cause, they would lament. I would nod and think to myself, that's why I should be in her place. And one day I said it out aloud, surprising even myself. The elections will be held soon. I am thinking of contesting. The replies were even more surprising as people began to agree with me. Well, you will certainly have our vote, they nodded. You understand us. You are one of us. It was not just the needy who came to see me. The ones with too much money also came to me. Money is a habit, you see, and you know, once you get used to making it, it's hard to stop. You have to make more, at any cost. Please help us, Miss Nazo, the rich would say. Bagodi Sahab takes our money and there isn't any guarantee that he'll get the work done. Whereas with you, there's satisfaction every which way. At first, I would bristle at their snide remarks, but soon I got used to them. They just couldn't separate the woman from her sex, these rich fat men. But then, that wasn't my problem. My cupboards had overflowed and I had to open yet another savings account. If only Soldier Rahim could see me now. I'd smiled at the thought as I walked out to the bank. I see you are smiling too, but your smile is a sad one. You think I sold out. But Rani, it wasn't about greed. I wasn't materialistic. I was practical. Money was the only thing that could make me powerful. A powerless woman, you see, is a useless woman. You should know that.
Before we hear from the audience, just one last question from me, maybe my last question. Do you notice anything when you're reading out loud in your work that you don't, when you're just reading it silently?
Yeah, grammatical mistakes.
Yeah, I'm constantly editing in my head. I can't stop it. Yeah, I think I'm OCD or something.
Do you read out loud? Is that how you sort of notice things that aren't working?
Before it goes into...
Yeah.
Yes. I usually actually write in my head. I never have the time to really, you know, the luxury of sitting down and, you know, waiting for the thoughts to descend. So when I'm cooking or, you know, helping my kids with the homework or whatever mundane task, I try to, you know, back of my mind, I'm usually thinking about the scenes. And then I sit down and when I have some time, I download them from my mind onto my laptop. And then to see whether the speech is natural or whether it's working or not, I read it aloud. I usually do that a couple of times at different periods of time. You know, put it away for a while and then come back to it.
So if it doesn't roll off the tongue well, is that a good indication that it's probably not working on the page?
If I cringe, you know, that's a good indicator, yeah.
Okay, so we'd love to hear questions from you, and to allow for as many questions as possible, please, I'd appreciate if you kept them brief, and also I'll stress the word questions rather than comments. So there should be is there a microphone being passed around? Gentleman in the front.
I am Ahmed Sohail from University of Management and Technology, Lahore. My question is from both of you. What things do you find more easy or difficult? Crafting believable dialogues, creating compelling characters, understanding the science of the story, terminologies or jargons, or the death mechanisms and investigations? Wow. Thank you very much.
That's a whole novel.
ये बता दिया तो फिर हम किस काम के रहे?
बताओ खुद ही जाके लिख लेंगे सर. Would you like to ask that?
आपका सवाल ये था कि which is more difficult?
Or easy?
Which are more easy? I don't know if it's a case of easy or difficult. I think it's a case of which is more interesting. For me, for instance, the creation of characters is the most interesting. And then the way I work is that when it comes to dialogue, it should be the sort of dialogue that you would have in a conversation. So it should not, you know, sound perhaps overly dramatic or whatever. That's the sort of tone that I usually try and fit into. In terms of jargon and all, I don't know if I have much jargon. But I do, you know, if you read any of my books, you do find that there's a lot of colloquialisms, a lot of abuse that is in it, which is again, for me, lends to making the entire book, giving it a feeling of being very sort of grounded in reality and very earthy.
Yeah, I think you can't really do one without the other. I think it's all connected. Don't you feel like, you know, if you have strong characters, you know, the dialogue is going to flow pretty naturally.
And the dialogue has to fit the character, right? So
it
has to fit his or her personality.
Yeah, I mean, there's this thing they say in literature, in fiction, voice, the voice. When you find the right voice for your character, I think it all begins to fall into place. One thing I used to struggle with when I was initially trying to write was how to amalgamate a good strong character with a good strong storyline, because just because you have a strong character doesn't mean the story is going to be very strong as well. So that for me is challenging, to find a good plot, a good hook, and combine that with an equally strong character.
Just like to follow up with a quick question, and that is, has your experience as a writer changed what you look for as a reader, or told you something that you didn't know before on what makes a good novel work?
Yeah, for instance, I find that if I refer back to all three books, I find that there's a progression. And it seemed, it's not as if I sort of sat down and told myself that this works or this doesn't work, but I think it's something that comes naturally with the more you write and with experience and sort of seeing what people, what aspects people engage with and what they found less interesting. So I think there is a natural progression as you go on, definitely.
Oh, I thought you were going to ask, you know, change as a person, and I was going to say, no, I'm still the same boring old person. But
you haven't bought a yacht yet.
No, nay, unfortunately, you know, maybe after I've written three novels like you. but as a reader, there is a huge change. I feel very frustrated now, you know. I feel like before I could just enjoy a good book. Now I find myself very frustrated because I feel that, oh, you know, I wish my narrator had a voice like that. Oh, I wish I could, you know, do this effortlessly. I wish I, you know, had a strong hook like that. So yeah, I think I've become very technical in my appreciation of novels.
Front, and then.
Thank you, Shehryar. If I may ask a question each of Sabyn and Omar. My name is Sadia Khan. I'm a writer of crime nonfiction, i.e. corporate governance. So,
oh, that's a bit
removed from this.
Bordering on crime.
But first, Sabyn, I thoroughly enjoyed reading your book.
Thank you.
And what's fascinating about the book is not just the story about Nazo and Rani, but also the emotional journey that the reader goes through between the sympathies, shifting sympathies between the protagonist and the antagonist. There was one point in the novel I felt almost depressed, and that was after, I think, Nazo received the hardest of the punches she receives through the course of this book. And I felt, not that I've ever harbored political ambition, but if I ever did, I would think twice after reading this book. I mean, it seems like a hard reality check. In this day and age when we need more female leaders rather than less, is this going to encourage more to step forward?
That's a really interesting question, Sadia. And I think that's why I have two perspectives. You know, the punishment that is meted out to Nazo is not so much because of her political ambitions. It's more about class. It's about what you can get away with someone who's from an underprivileged background and what sort of advantages someone coming from a privileged background has. There have been, not maybe in our country, but in India, you know, female politicians who've absolutely risen from the ashes, and there have been horrific incidents surrounding them. It hasn't deterred them. But having said that, you know, politics is not the only place where there is, you know, harsh discrimination against women. I mean, you see violence against women in our society everywhere. Just last week, there was, you know, absolutely disgusting things happening where, you know, all sorts of sexual violence was taking place against children. So I think violence against women is everywhere. It's not subjected to politics. And I really hope that, you know, it won't deter anyone from coming into this field. We definitely need more representation. I wish fiction had the power to encourage someone or deter someone, but I don't think it does.
I saw a hand there, gentleman in the third row.
I have a question to both of you guys. I haven't read your book, but I would love to know that you had been in Pakistan, and you, when it comes to writing crime fiction, one name rings in my mind, and that is of Ibn Safi. So I would love to know if you have had any inspiration from him while writing.
No, sadly not. Uski wajah ye hai ki, unfortunately, my ability to read Urdu is limited to FIRs and nothing more creative than that. And so I feel, for instance, that there is a great literary tradition that deals with, you know, crime or thrillers in Urdu that jisse main zati taur par mehroom. So definitely ye baat hai.
Are FIRs inspiring?
As long as they're not as creative as my books.
Yeah, I just feel, you know, ki itna crime hai hamare shehar mein, hamare shehron mein, ki, you know, aapko literature waise padhne ki to zarurat hai hi nahi, ki aapko thrills waise hi mil jate hain, you know.
I saw a question.
A couple of questions.
Thank you very much. I have questions from both writers. My first question to you, Sabyn, I'm sorry I haven't yet read your book.
You have it, so that's a good
interesting
sign.
So I'll get it signed from you and all. I'm also a teacher. Has any of your writing rubbed onto your students, and how do you make students think creatively? Because my students simply don't want to think, so creativity is something that comes a next step. So if you could kindly share your views on that. And Omar, from you I would like to ask, out of the three books, which is your most favorite, which is your baby, so to speak, so far? And should we be expecting something closer to Solid Mirza Case coming as your fourth book?
I thought you were going to ask, has some of my creativity rubbed off on some of my police officers?
Sure, that's a third question. Thank you.
You want to take that?
That would be really nice.
I hope not.
You know, I'm so surprised that you asked that, because I was just having a discussion with my colleague the other night about how there's this reluctance to produce original work. I can ask my students to produce research papers, reflection papers, but if I would ask them to sit down and write something original, there's this hesitancy, there's this resistance, you know? It's just, they're terrified. And I think that has something to do with the educational system that they go through, and they're not able to make that transition very effectively from secondary schools to higher education, where they are expected to think critically, and actually, you know, nobody is judging them on what they think. But there is awareness, and I think people are working on that. Yesterday there were some really interesting sessions on, you know, the history project and how they're making a conscious effort to change things around. For my students, it helps that, you know, I am able to tell them that, look, there is no such thing, for me at least, as talent or muse. I try and give them examples of our writers like Ismet Chughtai, who wrote on a takht in the middle of a hallway with all sorts of distractions, or Rashid Jahan, who wrote between her medical practice, or Manto, who wrote on the desk of his editor, you know, one leg swung over the chair, and not really sitting down and waiting for the muse to descend, you know, that whole room of your own theory. So I try and encourage them to be creative, to pen down their thoughts whenever they have the time, to just sit down and write, you know, not really wait for that kefiyat to descend. I show them my own graphs and charts. I've never claimed to be a natural writer. I'm not a natural writer. I can't sit down and, you know, the thoughts just flow. I have my techniques, I have my workbooks, I have my graphs and charts, and I share that with them, and I tell them, you know, anyone can write if they just have the discipline. So hopefully that should work. I forgot the rest of your question, have I?
Yeah.
Yes, okay.
Sorry,
your favorite
the
book.
Question was my favorite yeah. book. You know, your books are a bit like your children, you don't really want to play favorites with them. I think it's not a case of a favorite book. I think it's a case of, for instance, I find interesting or favorite chapters or more characters from each of the books. You know, so for instance, I've always said that I think that the character of Ozzy in The Spinner's Tale is, because he was a very difficult character to write, someone that I enjoyed writing, or the journalist Ismail Naich in this book was, you know, because there's an irreverence to him, I enjoy him as a character. And your second question was about future content. My next book, which I'm sort of in the middle of right now, is actually a total sort of turn away from what I've written in the past. I've gotten, for the timing, a little bored of writing about sort of Karachi and its dynamics and politics. So the next book is actually about match fixing. So it's a completely different topic. So let's see, you know, how much fun I have with that, and then let's see if I want to come back to this stuff later on.
Can we tell the audience that it has a very strong female protagonist that I'm really happy about?
There's nothing but female protagonists. This is the women's cricket team.
Yeah, I'm very pleased, because I feel that, you know, there's very, very little strong female representation in fiction coming out of Pakistan, especially by male writers. So I'm very pleased about that, and I hope you'll also work on that. That's the teacher in me coming out again.
So. I am. We only unfortunately have a couple of minutes as usual, not enough time. So I'm going to very arbitrarily, I know there's a lot of hands up, but I'll just swing to the other side of the room now. And I'm sorry for whoever didn't get a chance to ask a question, but the writers will be available after this to sign books and hopefully to take any questions that weren't asked.
Shaista, thanks to both authors, and I think the comment or the request for a question answer is to both.
You talked about getting kids to write creatively, but we live in the age of the internet, okay, and there's always snippets. You know, when you look at kids, to get them to read novels, I mean, they're so superficial in their understanding, as well as this almost scanning through a lot of the information that they need to grasp for whatever purposes. So, from the perspective of getting their attention and getting them into creative literature and actually read a book, from my experience, is sort of almost like a task and a half. So what's your recommendation around that? Because that has an implication on future novelists as well. You know what I mean?
30 seconds each.
Yeah. But I just say that we were just discussing this, I think, some time ago, that, you know, I feel that these days we don't really compete with other writers. We compete with the smartphone because technology has literally taken over our attention spans. My answer to that is that literature also needs to evolve. And, you know, I made a conscious effort in my novel that no scene is longer than a couple of seconds so that it keeps the reader's attention span. And, you know, as shallow as it sounds, it was a deliberate stylistic effort to keep people's attention. And very quickly, I'll pass it on to you.
Yeah, I agree. It's, you know, in this, with the problem that we face with technology, it is harder and harder. You've got to, as a writer, keep your audience engaged. And, you know, if that means that you're not going to describe the color of the rhododendron bush, or, you know, that's just the way it is.
Sabyn and Omar, thank you so much. And thank you all for coming here. Thank you for your questions. And see you next time.
Thank you for having us.